ومريم ابنة عمران التي أحصنت فرجها فنفخنا فيه من روحنا وصدقت بكلمات ربها وكتبه وكانت من القانتين.
In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful, you're welcome to another exciting edition of our yearly program. This year, we are going to be discussing a topic evolving around something you really want to listen to. This year, the theme is Evolving a Virtuous Society. I am your anchor on this program, and I am Bushra Olagunji Musodik. Join me as I welcome the lecturer after this short break. Do not go away.
وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يدعون إلى الخير ويأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر وأولئك هم المفلحون ولا تكونوا كالذين تفرقوا واختلفوا من بعد ما جاءهم البينات وَأُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ.
Welcome back. It's still your program, our program. And like I said, this time around we are discussing a very beautiful topic. Do you want to guess what the topic is? Well, let me introduce the lecturer in the house. She is Ajia Mutiat Juma. Salaam alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, my sister.
Well, welcome to the program. Nice to have you around.
Thank you very much. Nice to meet you again this year.
Alhamdulillah. Thank you very much. How's the family? How's work?
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.
Alhamdulillah.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Well, viewers at home, today Hajia Mutiat Juma is going to be taking us through the topic, Tolerance and Pardon. I'm sure, like you are all aware, that our program, they're always educating, entertaining. Please call everybody at home. The program is about to begin. Like I said, the topic is tolerance and pardon. I'm surprised. Why is the Believing Women organization coming up with such a topic during Ramadan? The two topics look alike. Are they different in context and meaning? Tolerance and pardon, do you want to explain?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Tolerance and pardon, they are similar,
okay.
They are alike. And these are two beautiful virtues that should be found in every believer.
Wow.
Because for every relationship we have in life, we need to exhibit these two characters. They are just too important. You see, tolerance is about you condoning or try to accept what someone does to you that you don't really like. You don't agree with that thing. There could even be excesses of the person, there could be annoying, there could be unpleasant things. But when these things come up between yourself and another person,
okay,
your that desire in you to keep down, you know, your temperament at that particular time.
To stay calm.
To stay calm, to accept whatever the person has said, and not you returning back, not you revenging, accepting it and, you know, letting life move on. Believing that as we are all human beings, we have our defects and we have our shortcomings. And at certain moments in our life, we exhibit all this. So when we come in contact with friends, neighbors, between the mother and the child, between husband and wife, when we have issues that we don't actually like, the best thing for us is to try and tolerate, accept, and then we move on with life.
Well, I like that. Well, viewers, we move on with life. That was what Hajia Mutiat just told us. I want to assume that in as much as these two words look similar and they are virtues that we should all try to imbibe, there seems to be something common to them. I think that has to do with the temperament. How does the temperament of an individual affect their level of tolerance and pardon?
Actually, you know, people react to things differently.
Obviously.
React to motivations, that's react true. To occasions that bring sorrow or pain to us in different ways. Some people, naturally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us with different temperaments.
Okay.
Some people are soft-hearted, you see then they are easygoing. Some are hard-hearted. Some, they boil. Every time, they're always like in a turmoil. And you see their face hard, harsh. And whenever there's a clash between you and them, they throw everything into the air. And then they'll become so much upset, and then they'll spit fire, like
the oven. So difficult to even control.
So difficult to control. So there are people like that. That's why Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam advised us that we should try and have a large heart, because as our heart gets better, as we have good manners, they all emanate from the heart. So they will sort of erase all these ill feelings that we might even get because somebody has provoked us. So if you are bad mannered, there is that tendency that our tolerance circle will be so short. But if you are good mannered, our tolerance circle will be wide. We want to accommodate, and then we want to pardon. That's why I said tolerance and pardon, they come peri passu. When you tolerate someone, you at the end of the day, you pardon the person. The person has made mistakes. This has committed errors against you.
You easily overlook.
Because you believe that, as I said earlier on, we are bound to make mistakes. No, there's no perfect human being anyway.
There is no perfect.
So definitely, when mistakes come from someone to you, the best is for you to try and overlook and then pardon the person. So you can move on with life. And every other thing will come in as you actually want.
So it means that there is no way you can actually dissociate pardon from tolerance. The two has to go together. Well, thank you very much. For those of us that are just joining us, it's still your program. And the topic today, like I said before, is tolerance and pardon. Hajia Mutiat, you mentioned something along the line. You were trying to tell us how tolerance and pardon could be exhibited within different levels of relationship. Does it mean that it doesn't have to do with just being Muslims? Does tolerance and pardon have effects, probably family level, friends, associates? How do we relate tolerance and pardon with the kind of relationship that happens between those people?
Islam wants us to exhibit this character in all our circumstances and in all relationships.
Okay.
Because when we relate with people, they have different temperaments and they react to things differently. So the best thing is for us to actually tolerate whatever we come across from our relatives, from those who are close to us. You see, in the society that we are in, I tell you, find out that people, there are clashes all over the place within families, and these clashes, they tend to generate. When you look at it critically, you discover that it actually started from someone. I mean, maybe it even came up as a result of just somebody abusing. That's where abuse and cause, those two things are around. Islam discourages people to abuse, and they discourage people to even cause. Even causing in immaterial things, it is not allowed in Islam. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was going, and a man, his shirt was flown away by the wind, and he was cursing the wind. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam rebuked him and said, no, don't curse an immaterial thing, because this thing happened from the command of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. It happened under the control of Allah. He now said that to curse a thing, it is very, very sinful, because the cause will, at the end of the day, come back to you if that thing does not deserve it. So you want to say that the clothes deserved being caused. That is why we call it,
the wind deserved to be caused.
So if the person does not, if that thing or the person does not deserve that cause, and you actually cause the thing, then definitely the cause will come back to you. So it is always very good for us to try and avoid all these things in relationships that we have. Many clashes happen within families, as I was trying to relate the other time. And these clashes could actually be a result of somebody, just one person out of the family, caused it, put the spark in the combustible material. And then it goes on and on and on and on. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam also advised us. He said that in such a situation, the sin will come on the head of that person that started it first. So we should try and make sure that when things like this they come up, the best thing for us is to try. Remember Prophet Sallam, in so many situations, he demonstrated this tolerance. And then at the end of tolerance, there's that good feelings that will come up naturally.
There's that rest of mind. There's that peace of mind.
That will come up naturally.
That's a very beautiful one. Thank you very much. Well, you tried along the line to mention something about how the Prophet exhibited examples of tolerance and pardon during his lifetime. Well, just before we go into that, let me remind our viewers again that the topic is pardon and tolerance. And like you know, we're in the month of Ramadan. This is the time for you to imbibe as much as you can afford. This is the time for you to practice, to make practical steps towards being a better Muslim. Join us after this short break. Do not go away. It's still your program. We'll be right back.
Allahumma anta salam.
Alhamdulillah. Ayida adewa yi irorun ti de lati rowo dokowo sowo lona alal albaraka albaraka microfinance bank bank to gba we gbonte ijoba lati ma sise gege bi bank alabode eyi ti ki gba owo ile lori owo tan ba ya won ni bara won albaraka microfinance bank ton seto ban tan se maratu ni ti mu ale ni wa si imuse bi edawo die die lati lo sise aja bi umura lati san wo lewe omo edawo lati je ki okowo eni gberu si lojo waju lati komosalasi edawo fodun leya ohun itunu awe abi edawo lati fi sori nkankan pataki ati bebe lo be ni won tun seto ajo ojojumo o to nu ati wo omo lu abi nile ise albaraka microfinance bank fi sise number 67 ladipo street legbe ladipo police station mushin nile ise albaraka microfinance bank wa telephone 08033814982 Albaraka Microfinance Bank Bankiwa Iyiwa
Fabima rahmatin min Allah linta lahum walau kunta faddan ghalidha alqalbi lanfaddu min hawlik fa'fu anhum wastaghfir lahum washawirhum fil amr فإذا عزمت فتوكل على الله إن الله يحب المتوكلين إن ينصركم الله فلا غالب لكم وإن يخذلكم فمن ذا الذي ينصركم من بعده وعلى الله فليتوكل المؤمنون.
Welcome back. I'm still your uncle for today, and the program is the one you have been enjoying. I'm still your uncle, and I'm Bushro Olamojo Musodik. But with me in the house, it has been a very interesting moment with Hajia Mutia Juma. She's been taking us through the topic pardon and tolerance. Well, before we went on the short break, you wanted to cite examples of how the Prophet exhibited. And you know, one of the things why, one of the reasons I so much always thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for being a Muslim is that for everything you do, you always have something to fall back on. It's either in the Quran or it's in the Hadith. So, you know, I always tell people, anything you want to do must have, you know, a backing that you can be so sure of. So try to tell our people at home that this thing that we are saying is not something new. It's not something they can't do. So try to tell us how it happened during the time of the Prophet and his companions.
The Prophet was the best example to us all. There were actually countless moments in his life that he actually they demonstrated this virtue you're talking about, the tolerance and pardon. But this particular beautiful one I want to relate to our dear brothers and sisters at home. There was a time a Bedouin Arab. Bedouin Arabs are Arabs that live in the outskirts of the desert, they live in the tents, they are raw. This man came up to the Prophet and asked him, he said, "Oh Rasulullah, give me something. I want a gift from you." Wow. Rasulullah looked and he brought out something and gave it to this man. Do you know what the man said? After giving this gift to the man, Rasulullah asked him, "Have I treated you well?"
Wow.
Can you guess the reply of this Bedouin? Don't bother.
Okay.
The Bedouin now said, "No, you have not treated me well." The Muslims are wrong. The companions, you know, they were angry. They wanted to advance towards this man. Prophet made a sign to stop them. He said, "No, stop." And he got up, he went into his house, and he gave this Bedouin Arab more gifts. And he asked him thereafter, "Are you satisfied now? Are you okay with what I've given you now?" He said, "Yes. May Allah grant prosperity to your family." Prophet said, "Good. What you have told me now, if you like, you may repeat it before my companions." And he actually agreed. So the next day, the man came on board. When he came, Prophet pointed at him and told the companions, "That is, this man requested for gifts yesterday. I went to him to give him more. And then he said that he is pleased and happy what I've given him." He now asked the man, "Is that so?" The man said, "Yes. May Allah bless the family of Prophet." So and he left. Prophet explained to the companions. He said, "Look, Initially, you wanted to advance towards him. If I had allowed you, you would have killed this man, and this man would have gone to hell. So you can see that from the beginning, the professor was not provoked by the behavior of this man. Because this man, he, as I said, is very raw. He's habituated to wild and vulgar language. So because Prophet Salam actually understood his temperament, his nature, okay, he was able to actually, be above it all. He was now explaining this analogy to the companions. He said, my example and that of this man is like a man who lost his she-camel in the desert. Wow. And while he was, looking for this she-camel, the people around were actually helping. They were running after the camel. As they were running after the camel, the animal was getting more startled, trying to move away. The man now said, look, don't worry. Leave me and my she-camel alone. I know her ways, and I know how to bring her back to the right path. And he suddenly took some grass from the ground, put them in his two hands, and showed them to this she-camel. And immediately the she-camel came back to sit just beside by the feet of this man. And at the end of the day, he actually rode on it. So Jesus was trying to let us realize that, the fact that this man has done the wrong thing, he has said a vulgar language.
He should not be confrontational.
He should even ignore and try to show more love. Jesus showed more love by giving him more gifts. Just like this, the shepherd that lost the she-camel showed the camel a sign of love. And this actually brought it back. So this is how we should try to relate to ourselves. There are lots of examples. There's another one of another Bedouin. The Bedouins are known to be like that, This was even at the time Prophet Salam was trying to distribute the booties of war.
Okay.
Prophet Salam was retributing. While he was doing that, the Bedouin came. He insulted Prophet Salam. He insulted him. He told him, oh, Prophet, deal justly.
He was telling the prophets that?
He said, oh, Prophet, deal justly with the booties. Because these booties are to be distributed under the pleasure of Allah. The pleasure of Allah is doing salt in these booties. Prophet Salam kept quiet and said, fine to you. If I do not deal justice, who else will? If I fail to do justice, it means I have failed and I have sustained a great loss. So you can imagine the way Prophet Salam answered this man. If it had been myself or yourself,
we wouldn't have been that patient.
Well, in fact, the Muslims were actually ready to kill him. But he said no. So this is, you can see, it is telling us that we need to be tolerant. Especially in this present situation, in this society of ours, that every now and then we go into the buses, the bus conductors are there.
You can say that again.
They are not just patient with you. And before you say anything, they give you 100.
All abuses at you.
All abuses and they yell. Just as Sam said, do not insult people by yelling at them. A Muslim should not yell at another person. The fact that you are yelling means you are insulting the person. So we should try and, speak with ourselves and make level. We try and tolerate all these excesses. And we should remember the temperaments of whoever we are dealing with. If you're dealing with a bus conductor, they're also raw, uneducated, illiterate.
So you have to know how to handle it.
If you don't handle the situation very well, and you kind of want to retaliate, you want to try and defend yourself, you are bringing yourself down to the level of these people, and then before you know it, things start escalating. Before you know it, you find yourself, you will be ashamed of what will happen at the end of the day. So the best thing is for us to actually ignore, and then by the time you ignore, he's not getting a response from you. Definitely, if he's not mad, he will have to keep quiet.
Obviously, he will.
That is justice.
Well, I like the moral aspects to it, that you don't disgrace yourself, you don't disregard yourself by trying to, yell at people or use abusive languages while relating with them. Well, Haji Amotiat, it's been a very wonderful time. But it's the month of Ramadan, and our viewers at home, they want to know, this is the month of mercy, the month of forgiveness. They want to know, how can they begin to, prepare towards practical steps? They want to imbibe these virtues. They want to be tolerating. They want to know how to pardon people, overlook things and all. What are the steps they can take towards it?
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. The month has come and we've been in it. Prayers for Tolerance. Accept all what you have done in it as acts of ibadah. Tolerance is very, very important for us at this particular situation, at this particular moment where we are fasting. Prophet once advised his companions that whenever you're fasting and someone comes trying to, you know, trying to irritate you, trying to upset you. You don't throw away the band and say, is it because I'm fasting? Ah, I have strength. You think because I'm fasting, it is. Prophet said, if you do that, you have wasted your fast. Because that's why I will not accept such a fast. Prophet said, the best thing for you to do is tell the person, I am fasting, and that is all. That is, ignore the person. Try to move away from that
environment.
Prophet said, when you are angry and you're standing, try to sit down. When you're sitting down, you're still very much angry, take your kettle, make ablution. By the time you do all that, definitely the anger will stem
down.
Yeah, it will cool down. And then you come back to your normal self. So the best thing for us is to try and tolerate people, especially at this point, as well as our reward will be in manifold before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Well, Haji Amutiyat, can you please briefly just tell us what are the effects of intolerance? You know, people might feel that we have spoken about tolerance and pardon. If I decide not to imbibe these virtues, what will be the aftermath result?
Actually, the major result of intolerance is anger. Yes. And anger has a lot of devastating effects.
How bad could it be?
A man could be angry, such that he could even be mad at the door. He wants to enter and the door is not opening and he will start cursing the door.
The door?
Because it refuses to open.
Serious.
So you can imagine. You see, anger, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam actually told us. He said, an angry man is like a madman. Now, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was asking the companions, he said, do you know a sando? A sando, as he saw, a powerful person. Mm-hmm. The people say, the people we call sandos among us are those who will never be knocked down by another person. That is, those who cannot be, you know, you can't win them, maybe in wrestling or in battle or in boxing or whatever. First, I said, no, that is not a sandal. A sandal is that man who can control his anger. So if you can control your anger, you'll be able to tolerate. But if you cannot control your anger, that's where intolerance comes in.
Okay.
And the result is something that you too, at the end of the day, by the time someone is angry and you're acting at that particular time, by the time that thing is being replayed to you, you will say,
you won't believe it wasn't me.
You can even remove your hijab because you're angry.
You could be that bad that you could curse.
You could swear.
You could even destroy things.
You could even destroy. In fact, yes, you could break machines and say, find them in your hands, and you want to imagine what has happened. Nothing except the fact that you have allowed anger to take over you. Anger, they say, it comes from the flame of hellfire. And that is why once is in someone, it keeps on burning, and the flame comes out, and then the person, her eyes will be reddish, the nostrils will be enlarged, you will be sweating from head to toe, and the person will not even be, there will be complete loss of intelligence and consciousness.
Too bad.
And that is why you find out that at the end of the day, you do things that are very destructive. So this is one great factor that comes out of intolerance. So does it watch it? Because you don't want to tolerate just something small.
It's not.
And then you decide to create something very big and
the damage is.
The damage, this damage you're talking about
is irreparable.
Irreparable for life, my dear. Irreparable for life. So even if somebody is at the corner pinching you, where nobody is seeing you, and you want to react in the open, everybody will say, oh, look at her. But so you need to actually, you know, try to tolerate. Even if at the face of, you know, what you don't like, you take it. For the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, on the day of Qiyamah, he's going to build for some people tall buildings in paradise. These people are those who are able to control their anger. And those who are able to pardon the mistakes of people. That's what Allah says, he's going to build for us tall buildings in Al-Jannah. When you remember all this, it will actually tell you that you need to actually, you know, exhibit this character. And you pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you. Because at times, it might be something that has been part of you for so many years. Because I said it's a natural, it's a kind
something
of...
Something you have to learn how to do.
Learn how to undo. Learn how to come out of it. And by the time you study the Quran, by the time you study Hadith, you find a lot of things helping you to shape your life and to you to actually move out of this mess that you are in.
Well, Jazakumullah khairan. At this point, I must say that our viewers at home, like she has said, so that our rewards could be manifold in this month of forgiveness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us our shortcomings. For those of you who have listened today, please pass on the message. As Muslims, we should learn to imbibe these two virtues, tolerance and pardon. Like I always tell you on this program, you will learn more than you can imagine. Join us tomorrow, this time, same station, for another beautiful edition of this program. I am Bushro Olagunji Musodiq. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
آمنتُ بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر والقدر خيره وشره من الله والبعث بعد الموت لا إله إلا الله. آمنتُ بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر.